Welcome to a lesson with Dr. Powell. Let's look at an adjacency matrix on a directed graph. This graph is directed because its edges have a direction, and so it's called a digraph. Now, we're going to answer a question, and this question is, given a collection of these vertices, and it could be a multi-set, you could double one up. For now, let's just do a collection of just two simple things like V1 and V2. So in this collection, we're going to look at what happens and how to get to this collection via one arrow from the other or from the four different vertices. Of course, notice that you can get to this collection from itself, maybe. And so we're going to count how many different ways there are of getting to this collection from each one of these via one length of a path, one arrow length. So V4, how many different ways are there of getting from V4 into this collection? Now notice there are zero. Okay, V4 has no paths that go right into there, that's zero. What about from V3? So V3 has an arrow, one arrow that goes from itself to V1. So it looks like there is one. Now what about V2? V2 has no one length arrow that goes out of it into the collection at all. So it's just, so into this collection, there's zero. What about from V1 into this collection? Well, go from V1. To V2. Hey, that goes into the collection, so there's one. This means that if we input this into our question function, we should get out something that looks like a tuple here, 1010. In particular, let's imagine that V1 is represented as a tuple. 1000 itself. V2 has 0100. So these are like standard basis elements in a free, so Z module, Z4. So they live, the vertices live in Z4. And we're considering a function that goes from Z4 to Z4. We just input a collection. We can represent the collection V1, V2 by a vector, which we'll write as a column, 1, 1, 0, 0. And the output should be 1, 0, 1, 0. Well, let's make a matrix for this function. If we suppose that it's a Z module map. So it preserves the Z module structure from here to here. This should make sense because we're counting paths into, and those counts simply add as we put more things in here, or even if we double up or something, and also outside multiplication, taking multiples of things should behave nicely in such a counting question. So this is a Z module map that we're looking at, so we can build a matrix for it. How do we build that matrix? We simply need to know what the image of each one of the standard basis elements is, and then we're set to go. Okay, so let's build a matrix. All right, let's look at the image of V1. Image of V1, so what comes into V1? Well, it looks like the only thing that comes into it is from V3. And just one from V3. Now, what about F of V2? What comes into V2? Well, it looks like lots of things come out, but there is one thing coming in from V1. So 1000. What comes into V3? Well, let's see. We have one thing from V2 and itself goes into it. So we have a 1, 1, a 0, 0. Now what comes into V4? Ah, looks like two arrows from V2. Okay. And one from itself. This is a matrix which describes this adjacency question of being one away before. So coming from. So this is paths from things into V1. So how to get to these vertices as destinations. This is called the adjacency matrix, or we could call it an adjacency map. Adjacency matrix. And so let's think about this. If we were to input this into the matrix, that's the same thing as adding the first column to the second column, because it's like in the domain, it's like we're adding V1 and V2, and this structure should be preserved to the codomain. So we're just adding columns. So adding these two columns up, we get this as desired. So we have our map, our adjacency map or adjacency matrix, which works very nicely here on this diagraph. Thanks for watching.